use this opportunity to let you know how the verbal instructions went among the Native Americans, but they didn't have writing as we know it, although it appears that all the tribes had writing societies of some kind, but it was secret. Only a few people knew how to write, and that includes the Ho-Chunk, and they had a script not entirely different than some of the other tribes further south, like the Cherokees. But be that as it may, most of the instruction here, be it in a medicine lodge or sweat lodge, was verbal. But it's not like standing in a gym and whispering to the person next to you and passing the word around and it gets distorted. It was more like we would relate to the Masons today, where there's a certain initiation ceremony that is passed on from generation to generation, but that person has to learn that chant verbatim, and he's tested to make sure he's got everything just right. And that's the way, as I understand it, was done in the native languages as well. There was an old elder with the Ho-Chunk by the name of Jones Funmaker, who I met when he was 72 and 73, about my age, and he'd never learned really how to read and write. He had instead gone to learn in his father's sweat lodge, he said, every morning instead of going to school. He'd get up and sit in the sweat lodge and listen to the old chants and the songs. And you get half unconscious, and then the song starts, the chant. And it is, you do that until it's embedded in your brain. And then when you're in a similar situation and everything's just right, you're half unconscious, like a tape recorder comes on. And so that's a little different than passing a word to the next person that goes around and comes back entirely different. I'm not privy to what's in the whatever's left of the old verbal traditions, but I do know they talk about when the ice walked on the land, when the big animals came to the lush vegetation at the foot of the glacier, they came across the Mississippi River, and where they crossed, about how you kill a mastodon, you hit him right in the back of the neck with a spear, and that you attack that muscle and they can't lift their head up and they suffocate. When the big bears, bigger than our grizzly bears, walked the land and you didn't go out unless there were 8 or 9 people because they eat you. And about the mastodons, babies being attacked by the cat with the long teeth. And there are mounds like that in this state still, in isolated places, like a mastodon on his side, of a small mastodon being attacked by a cat with long teeth, teeth being a big rock. In the medicine bundle of some of these keepers of the bundles, they still have a saber-toothed cat tooth. So you can imagine coming to an ancient site and telling these stories and then passing it around. What an impression that would be on a child. If things were just right, it would go right into the brain. That's still going on to some extent. But the youth are now watching TV games, and they're changing. So we're in changing times. And I'm very concerned that the people that still have the stories do something, whatever they can, to preserve those stories so that they don't get lost as they were kept primarily in secret. And I know that various folks here are interested in helping them to whatever extent we can, if they want to do it. When I first started surveying these mounds, they were very secretive. And I was lucky to meet a few people who were able to willing to share. But then the Pamita said, when the white buffalo is born, everything's going to be different. And we'll share.
The white buffalo was born.
And right then, the Mayans come up from Guatemala and say, we have now come to share information, but you have to ask. We're not going to lecture you. Now, there's division in the tribes, but I think you will find that the people who are preserving the information are very concerned that it doesn't get lost. Whatever way we can to preserve it, everybody's working toward that goal. And we're at an interesting change of time. I'm looking back over my shoulder here, not because I don't want to look at you, but because the sun's going to set pretty soon. And that's what this site is all about. And the other cross quarter days, fall cross quarter day, we all celebrate it. We know Halloween. And spring cross quarter day, Groundhog's Day. Now, in these ancient ceremonies, the period is important. But it might have been a ceremony that went on for 10 days. We're not looking for a particular day. So the spring cross quarter day in one culture, Lithuania, might be 5 May, somewhere else 1 May, 28th April. But we're talking about the period. And so this is dividing the year up into the warm seasons. From spring cross quarter day to the summer solstice and to the first, or the green corn ceremonies, or first fruits. Now, is there something unique about this? Well, it's an agricultural calendar, obviously. Now, to the Ho-Chunks, the area where the effigy mounds are in southern Wisconsin was called Aztalan, which means country of the wild rice. Ats mean wild rice. And it was the grain that could have been kept and stored for winter use here that grew. Because corn, back 600 AD, 800 AD, grew down in Illinois, but not this far north. It was a different kind of corn. And to grow up here, you have to be very, very tuned to that movement of the sun. Plant a few days one way or the other too far. You plant too late and the corn freezes, and guess what? So as corn moved north, that changed as well, of course. Now, it used to be 120-day corn, took that long to ripen. Then it became 90-day corn when I was a kid. Now they got 60-day corn or less. So it's changing too. But man changed as they brought it north. And to survive in one spot, you have to have a grain that you can store for winter use. Otherwise you pull up when you get all the animals killed off and the fish and move somewhere else. If you're going to have permanent village, you have to have grain. And here was wild rice. Now, Muscadah over here has different connotations and different languages. But one of them was the people who stayed put. So, if you're going to stay put in this valley, you're going to have to probably plant corn, not much wild rice. And so it all fits. It all fits pretty well.